Singing in the sun. You see how they're still doing that about 10 weeks.
I covered the number, okay.
Cambridge number.
Hey, you never know what you're going to see here. Bryce had this series on love going on for the last couple weeks. It seems like Bryce and Rob are taking it really serious. Well, you know, Diana Ross and Lionel Richie and Bryce and Rob, they sing of this love, and I hate to say this, every couple hopes for. There's only you in my life. You're my only breath, my every step. I want to share all my love with you. No one else will do. Oh yes, you'll always have endless love. You know, I that's the kind of love that I'd like to have. You know what I mean? I think that's the kind of love we all would like to have. And make every day worth getting up and going out and make work every day worth living. But the question is sometimes, how can we find this love, this endless love we've been talking about for the last couple weeks? We began this series about 2 weeks ago when we asked the question, and hopefully with God's help, we answered it, what is love? And then last week we asked, and I hope again with godly wisdom, we answered that question, what does love look like? So we asked, what is love? And then we asked, you know, what does that love look like? And today we're asking what I believe is probably the most important question of all. And that is, how can I have this kind of love that Paul has been describing to us in 1 Corinthians chapter 13? How can we have this endless love? Because who doesn't want to have this kind of love that we've been talking about? Now, normally, this is the part of the service where I'd say, if you missed last week, please go to our website, theodysseychurch.com, or go to the YouTube channel and watch it there for free. But we sort of had a technical problem last week. And by technical problem, I mean we had a Pastor Rob problem. I forgot to hit play on the video, so I've got to come back in here sometime this week and retape it. And hopefully, by the end of the week, we'll have both today's service and the other service both up online. But the first service is still there, so if you missed that, go and watch that, and then hopefully by the end of the week you can see both of us. Now, in the first service, not to give away the surprise ending or not to ruin it for you, we said that the answer to this, the best answer that I could find, the best way I could describe it, what is love, was love is the life of God. Because God doesn't just love. We know that He does, but God doesn't just love. But according to the Scriptures, God is love. So when we resemble the life of God, what we're doing is we're living out, we're displaying this love that Paul has been describing to us in chapter 13 to the people in this ancient city of Corinth. Now the thing is, if you were to ask somebody that understood the ancient Greek of this time, if you were to ask them what is love, and you offered no other explanation, they probably would look at you a little confused. They couldn't give you a true answer. And the reason for that, in the English language, we use love to mean many different things. Depending on who's speaking, depending on what we're speaking about, love can mean different things to different people. You know, in our everyday conversations, we use the word love in many, many different ways. Like, I love the fall. I love that hoodie type season. I love my new smartphone. I love my church family. I love my wife and kids. Sometimes. I love this person. I love this thing. I love this event. So when we think about it, the word love in the English language, it becomes pretty obvious that it can mean different things. Because when we talk about loving a phone or loving an event, it certainly doesn't mean the same thing as when I say I love my children. But the Greek, there's actually six different words that they use to describe love. Now, most people in churches have heard three, most theologians, most people who study other languages, linguists, they'll break it down into about three words, and that's because we talk about a word, ludus. And the word ludus is actually like a playful love. It's more of a flirtation type love than love itself. It's like the guy that's at the supermarket and he sees a really cute girl and he says, "Can I see the list of things you got to pick up?" And then he writes his phone number and his name on the list and hands it back to her. If you're a Christian, you know, Christians have their own pickup lines. Like, you know, I'm not saying I'm a prophet or anything, but I can see me and you together. Or, you know, last night I was reading the book of Numbers, and I noticed I didn't have yours. You know, the flirtatious type love, that's what they're talking about. So it's not really a love at all. And then there's the word pragma. You know, and that means a long-standing love. It's a mature love. It's like a couple that's been married for a long, long time. It's about compromising. It's about making an effort to make love last and not just receive love, but to give love back. It's the root word in the English language that where we get pragmatic. And in an adjective form, pragmatic means a practical point of view or a practical consideration. Now, as a noun, pragmatic means meddlesome, which could be another reason it relates to marriage. I'm not sure. Then there's the Greek word, and this Greek word is philotia. Philotia, it means self-love. Because the Greeks understood there's a dangerous kind of love. There's an unhealthy form of love. It's a love where you become focused on yourself. In the English language, we would say it was a narcissist or narcissism. It's focused on your fame, your riches, your fortune. A love of yourself where you actually become obsessed with yourself. So now we come to the three main words that we talk about when we speak about the Greek language and love. For those of you or those of us outside the church who say, well, maybe we don't speak enough or we don't go deep enough. Well, when you get the Greek language today, we're going real deep. Philia. Philia is a friendship type of love. This is the kind of love that brings loyalty to friends, brings loyalty to families. You sacrifice them. You show them your emotions. You're transparent with them. It's not the kind of love that you may have with your Facebook friends. You may say you love them, but you might have never even met them before. It's the kind of love a parent has for a child, or a brother has for a brother, or a sister has for a sister. One example, as I was doing the research, was the love that two warriors have who stood side by side in battle, that had saved each other's life, that had gone through conflict. It's a loyalty. Think of Philadelphia. Philadelphia gets its root from Philia. It's the city of brotherly love. And then there's Eros. Eros is sexual love. It's where we get our English word erotic from. It was named after the Greek goddess of fertility, but it wasn't usually thought of in the ancient Greek as a positive. In fact, it was viewed as very dangerous. It was a fiery, irrational form of love. It was the kind of love which could take a hold of you and it would possess you. Now, as Paul speaks in his writings, he doesn't use any of those five words. None of those words are the words that he uses. He actually uses a new word for a new thing. Apart from about 20 occurrences in the Greek Old Testament, there's almost no other place that you can find this word. It's almost non-existent before the New Testament. The word Paul uses seems to be a Christian invention. And the word is agape. It's exactly the opposite of philotia love. It's the opposite of self-love. Agape is selfless love. It's a different kind of love. See, agape draws its meaning directly from the revelation of God in Christ. It's not a natural affection. No matter how intense that natural affection is, that's not what Paul is talking about when he's talking about agape love. Agape love is the supernatural fruit of the Spirit. And we've been talking in the last couple of weeks, I mentioned Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23 often. The Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. And again, here in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and in Galatians chapter 5, Paul uses the same word. The Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives, agape, love. And by implication, what Paul is saying, if you have this agape love, then you're going to have joy, and you're going to have peace, and you're going to have patience, and you're going to have kindness, you're going to have goodness, you're going to have faithfulness, you're going to have gentleness, and you're going to have self-control. See, this kind of love is a matter of the mind rather than a matter of an emotional feeling. It's not something we can do on our own. It's the very basic element of Christ's likeness. The basic element of having the life that is the life of God. It's the kind of love we've been talking about over the last couple weeks. Paul said, if I could speak all the languages of the earth and of the angels, but I didn't love others, I would only be a noisy gong or a cymbal. If I had the gift of prophecy, and if I understood all of God's secret plans and possessed all knowledge, and if I had such faith that I could move mountains, but I didn't love others, if I didn't agape others, I would have gained nothing. See, Paul begins bringing his argument about love to a logical conclusion. This kind of love is the life of God. And since God not only loves, but is love, even if I had everything this world had to offer, even if I had all the wisdom of the earth, even if I knew all of God's secret plans, even if I gave away every single thing that I had in my life, even if I was able to give my own life, my own body, if I don't have this agape love, this endless love, this real love, then I don't have nothing. And since this agape love, this selfless love, is only found in God, if you don't have God, you can't have the love which comes from God. And if you don't have this kind of love, which only comes from God, then you have nothing. Everything else you have is just simply a waste. When Paul wrote to the Christians in Rome, he begins to make this point clear. Sometimes we only read this scripture over here and we try to explain it, but when you start putting everything together, you can start seeing how Paul absolutely was concerned about how the fact we love and how to get this love. Paul wrote to the Christian in Rome, he says, "For we know how dearly God loves us, because he has given us his Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love." God gives us his Holy Spirit for a reason. He gives it to us so that it can fill our hearts with love, to give us the power to love that we can't love in our own abilities. God gives us his Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with love. So how do we get this Holy Spirit so that our hearts can be filled with love? I'm so glad you asked. See, Paul tells us in another letter, this one to the Ephesians, chapter 1, verse 13. "And now you Gentiles," now see that's us, if you're not Jewish, you're a Gentile. "Now you Gentiles have also heard the truth, you've also heard the good news that God saves you, and when you believed in Christ, he identified you as his own by giving you the Holy Spirit, whom he promised long ago." God says, when you believe in my Son, you will be identified by that because you will have the Holy Spirit living in you. You can only have this love we're talking about, this agape love, this selfless love, if it's poured out into your heart by God himself, by his Holy Spirit, and we can only have God's Holy Spirit if we believe Jesus is who he says he is. You know the amazing thing, if we look at this, is that all three parts of the Godhead, the entire Trinity, is involved in agape love. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. The only way you can have the love God wants us to have is to accept what Jesus Christ did on a Roman cross. You have to believe that he died for you. You have to repent of your sins and believe the good news of the gospel. And when you believe that, by simple faith alone, the Holy Spirit will be given to you, and you can have the love of God poured out into your hearts by that same Holy Spirit. It is so simple. In fact, it is so simple that most people simply miss it. They simply never do it. And then last week, you know, we asked the question, what does this love look like? What does agape love look like? And Paul gives us this fantastic, this great description of what this love looks like and what this love doesn't look like. He says, love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It's not irritable. It keeps no record of being wrong. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. Paul begins to give us this beautiful description of what love is, what this agape, this selfless, this enduring, this endless love looks like, and what it doesn't look like. Sometimes I say to myself, I need to look in the mirror. Maybe we all need to look in the mirror one day and say, what are the evidences that I have this love? What is the evidence that this love is in my life? Do I resemble some of these things? Or do I maybe not resemble those things so much? Because here's the thing. So often we want this love and we just go after it with all we can. But you can't go after this kind of love and get it. You can't go after love. Don't go after love, but do go after Jesus. You don't go after love, you go after Jesus. You can only have this kind of love to the degree and only to the degree that you have Jesus Christ in your life. The more Jesus you have, the more love you'll have. Love is the life of God poured out in you by God's Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit can be only poured out in your life if you accept Jesus Christ as not just your Savior. Everybody loves Jesus as their Savior. But you have to actually make Him Lord over your life, which means you do what He asks you to do. And if you've never made that decision to let Jesus Christ be your Savior and your Lord, what better way to start out today? And by coming, it is where it all starts. To have the life which is God, you have to start with God. It starts with God, who is love. Now, I do know that that was a pretty long introduction, but I'm still going to get us out of here on time, I think. I'm pretty sure that we will. But this is so important. This is so important. Jesus tells us that we'll be known as His disciples by the way we love others. God said in the form of Jesus Christ that every one of the Ten Commandments is fulfilled in this one word, love. Everything that the prophet said in the Old Testament, everything that's ever been said hinges on this word, love. So it's really important. So I really want you to remember. I want to make sure that you remember. I want to make sure that I remember it. So that brings us to verse 8 this morning. Then we're going to finish this series on love, which Paul is describing on 1 Corinthians chapter 13. So if you have your Bibles, turn it into 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We're going to be reading verses 8 through 13. And if you don't have a Bible, that's okay. Follow along with me on the screen this morning. But pick one of those up on the way out. We've got several of them left, and when we run out of those, we'll order more. The Lord has blessed us, and we want to bless you, because there's only one book in the world that I believe will transform your life completely, and that is His Word, God's Word, what we call our Bible.
Amen.
So this morning, we start out in verse 8. Prophecy and speaking in unknown languages and special knowledge will become useless. But love will last forever. What Paul is saying, he sort of is reinforcing everything that he's already said. Everything he said in the previous verses. Love will last forever. Or some translations say, love will never fail. Now our knowledge is incomplete and partial. And even the gift of prophecy reveals only part of this whole picture. But when the time of perfection comes, these partial things will become useless. When I was a child, I spoke and I thought and I reasoned as a child. But when I grew up, I put away childish things. Now we see things imperfectly, like puzzling reflections in a mirror. But then we will see everything with perfect clarity. All that I know now is partial and incomplete. But then I will know everything completely, just as God knows me completely. Three things will last forever: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. So Paul begins to bring everything to a close, everything to a conclusion. Prophecy, speaking in unknown language, or what some say, speaking in tongues, the special knowledge that God gives some, it's all going to become useless. You're not going to need those things when you're in heaven. But love will last forever. Real love, this agape love, it's a survivor because it finds its source and its life in God Himself. It is truly an endless love. Everything else is only temporary. It's only incomplete. It's unreliable, but not love. By the grace and the strength of God, it can persevere and survive anything. It can survive any circumstances. It's the love which reflects the heart of Christ and the life of God. But if you're like me, if you're like most people, you're just thinking to yourself, how can I have this love? Because I've been to the altar. You know, I've asked Jesus Christ into my heart. I've tried to be patient. I've tried to be kind. I try not to be rude. I'm not easily angered, but I get angry. I just fail when I try to do these things. How can I have this love? I mean, I can be good for a little while, but then I just seem to go back to my old ways. See, I think there's hope here. I think there's comfort here anyway. Paul says, you know, we don't see the whole picture right now. Now, our knowledge is partial and incomplete, and even the gift of prophecy reveals only part of the whole picture. So we only see part of the picture of God's love for us. In this world, we only see part of how much God loves us. We can't comprehend His love for us. And we can't comprehend the love He wants us to have for others. We only see in part because we live in this fallen world. And the fact of the matter is, I believe this, that if we could see the true love of God and how He wants us to, I don't know if we could even handle it in our human form. But one day, he says, we will. He says, but when the time of perfection comes, these partial things will become useless. All these gifts that God has given us, all these talents He has given us that helps us along the way, to help us stay close to Him. He says, you're not going to need those anymore. When you see as God sees, you will do as God does. All these helpful things, all these things which try and hold us up are going to become useless. See, when you're trying to build a building, and you're doing the blueprints, and you got to figure out the roof pitches, and you got to find out the weight distributions, and you got to put all this together so that it's safe. Basic 2 + 2 math is not going to help you out. You need the more advanced stuff. You need trigonometry and algebra to help figure those things out. I mean, it was useful. It was helpful in the first grade. But as you get to college and into high school, that's no longer as useful as it used to be. Because you start to see clearly. You see why you needed the basic stuff at the time, but now you need the more advanced stuff. The purpose of the simpler things become clear. When I was a child, I spoke and I thought and reasoned as a child. But when I grew up, I put away childish things. Now we see things imperfectly, like puzzling reflections in a mirror. See, mirrors of Paul's time were made out of tin. They weren't very, it's like trying to look into a mirror and the mirror's distorted. They aren't like they were today. See, God doesn't want me to be a better me. God doesn't want you to be a better you. God wants you to be conformed and transformed into the very image of His Son, Jesus Christ. And we all know this is impossible for us. We can't do it. We've already tried. How many times have I tried and I failed? We might as well give up right now if it's up to us. It's absolutely beyond our capability. But the good news is, as I said earlier, we don't have to do it on our own. God does it for us. Only God can give us the life of God. Only God can give us the life of God, which is love. He has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with love. But here's the thing. We're not without responsibility. So often, our responsibility, we have to do something. Our responsibility is to pursue Jesus Christ. To have a life filled with Jesus Christ, that's our responsibility, is to allow God to produce this real love, this agape love, this endless love in us by believing in and filling ourselves with His Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus said, if you remain in me, I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it's severed from the vine. And you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. If we'll remain in Jesus, then Jesus will remain in us. As we learn to live and remain in Jesus, Jesus will remain in us, and He will live in us, and He'll give us the power to do what we can't do on our own. I cannot produce agape love, but Jesus can produce agape love, and Jesus living in me produces agape love through me. See, as we learn to abide in Christ, the very character of God, the life of God, which is love, can be produced by Jesus through us. Rather than us trying to produce love by ourselves, we tell God, you know what? I can't do this. But I believe, I know by faith that you can. I can't produce the love you're talking about, but your Holy Spirit living in me, you can do it through me. But I can't do it on my own. Paul's letter, he writes to the Philippians in what our Bible calls the book of Philippians, the apostle writes, for God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases Him. What pleases Him? When we obey His commands and when we love others. Where is God at work? He's at work in you and He's working me. See, I find that so amazing. Here's a God who doesn't need us at all. He's the creator of everything seen and unseen. He's creator of a universe that goes on forever. There are things in this universe we'll never, ever see. And yet He created this beauty anyway. And He has a personal concern and a personal love for each one of us. And not only does He have this love, He wants to work through us. See, it's not God working outside this building. It's not even God working inside this church. It's God working in each one of us. And you turn to your neighbor and say, God's working in you. And then let them say, God's working in you too. And then say, God's working in me. And I know I need a lot of work. So how do we have this love? We put aside our childish ways. We put away our childish thinking. We put it all behind us. Paul writes, this time to the Colossians. Now in chapter 3, verses 1 through 3, since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. See, when you come to Christ, when you believe by simple faith, it doesn't say when you believe because you've read enough of the Bible or you believe because you've seen His work. It's just by simple faith in Christ alone. When you believe Jesus is who He says He is, and you make Him Lord over your life, the Word of God says you're regenerated. You have new life. You've been made new. You died in this life, and your real life, which was hidden in Christ, hidden in God, you're in the process of being made new. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. You died in this life because you have your real life. It was hidden in Christ, in God, but now you have Christ. It's beginning to be revealed to you. It's a process of being made new. He tells us the secret to having this life that's hidden in Jesus. And we know that the life of God is love. This love that God has for you and this love that God wants us to give others. And the secret is to set your sight on the realities of heaven. Not on the things of earth. You say, well, I went to the altar. I just don't feel any different. I was there. I think this is where the church fails so often. I remember going to a church service, a church I went to, and every week the same guy would stand up and give a testimony about nursing homes he went to, and he'd just say, you believe in God and everything will work out okay. To some degree, that is true, because we all eventually will get to heaven. We tell people all you got to do is you come to this altar and everything's going to be okay. Everything will be taken care of. But that's not what God's word says. He says, think about the things of heaven and not the things of earth. You have to do your part so that God can do his part. You set your mind up. You make up your mind. You think about the things of heaven. You think about it. You make up your mind and you be filled with Jesus so you can be filled with the love of God. Let me ask you a question this morning. Think about this. I mean, it's sort of like a ridiculous example, but hopefully it'll all come together. Would you think this week you can do something specifically that will make you less loving? Do you think that you can do something that would keep you and keep others from seeing a godly love in you? To have this love, God wants you. I mean, is there something you can do at home like be even more impatient than you probably already are? I mean, maybe you could be less kind. Maybe you could go to work and you could be boastful and rude and be self-seeking. You go to the store and you get angry, you find some way to delight in the evils of the world. Now, I think that we all would agree that there's things that we can do to make us less loving, right? But if that's true, then the opposite must be true as well, right? There's something we can do to make us more loving. Not some kind of sloppy agape, but real, true love. God's love. Maybe we can go home and be more patient with our spouse and our children, even when things go wrong, as we know they sometimes will. Maybe we could commit an act of undeserved kindness. Maybe we could go out of our way to be polite to somebody at work that nobody else is polite to. Maybe we could go out and be kind to the stressed out cashier at the store. Try to find good in people instead of bad. I mean, if you agree that there's something we can do not to have this love, and you agree that there's something we can do that we can have this love, what we're actually saying is whether we have it or don't have it, it's up to us. It's not dependent on other people. It is dependent on us. Because what it means is we can do something even if the other person doesn't respond in the way we'd like them to do. We can do something that will make us more loving and feel that love. The choice to have real love that God desires us to have is simply up to us. Regardless of how much love you have in your life right now or how much love you don't have in your life right now, the choice is yours, no matter how the people around you treat you or even feel about you. You have to make a choice to have this agape love, this real love, this endless love, because real love is dependent on you and not dependent on them. You say to yourself, well, that's all really good. Well, that's really nice. I might be able to do that for a little while, but I can't keep it up long. I'll go back to my old ways sooner or later. Don't copy the behaviors and the customs of this world. But let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Let God transform you, change you, make you into a new person, make you into a more loving person by changing the way you think. I can do something that will either give me the love of God or deny me the love of God, and the choice is mine. And the way I think determines the person I become. I have to change the way I think. In other words, I have to repent. Because that's what repent means. Change the way you think so you change the way you act. See, becoming a Christian may put your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. It may save you from the wrath of God and the fires of hell. But it does not guarantee you that you'll be changed. To be transformed, to be changed, you have to change the way you think. You have to repent so you can change the way you act. Accepting Jesus as your Savior doesn't result in the love. That's where it all starts. But only transformation will result in the love that you desire. And in order for God to transform you, you have to change the way you think. In order to be transformed, we can't copy the behaviors of this world, but let God. See, it's not us. We have to let God, who changes us when we change the way we think. We begin to think and we begin to focus on the things of heaven and not the things of earth. God, who is love, is working in you and he's working in me. And what's he doing? He's taking away our childish things. He's transforming us. He's changing us. Change the way you think, and God transform you, and the result is you will die to self, you will die to this life, and your life which is hidden in Christ, your life which was hidden in Christ in God, becomes your new life. And the life which is hidden in God is love, because God not only loves, he is love. See, the world thinks, when you're thinking of worldly things, the world thinks that love is this kind of emotion. It's something that we get. It's something that other people do to us, and then we have a gushy-gushy feeling. But love isn't something you get. Love is something you give. How can you have this love? Be transformed. How do you become transformed? By changing the way you think. A renewed mind results in a renewed life. If we're to find this endless love, here's how it's going to work. Every day of your life, God is working in you to conform you into the image of his Son, Jesus Christ. Now the question is, do I let him do these things? Do I continue to think about the things of heaven, where Jesus sits in a place of honor and he rules? Or do I concentrate on the things of earth, where man has honor and Satan rules? The choice is mine. Will I work with God? Will I ignore God? Or even worse, will I work against God? It's my choice. And our thinking determines the direction that we go into. If you want to have love, you have to involve yourself in the process by changing the way you think. You have old beliefs about love, and you begin to put on a new attitude. You begin to put on new thoughts and new beliefs about love. And if you do, you will be transformed. I promise you that. Love isn't something you get. Love is something you give. And when you change the way you think, you will be transformed. Now, it sounds easy, but is it easy? Not always. Not most of the time, maybe. But not always. But it's always worth it. I'll share with you my personal experience. It was probably about 25 years ago. I don't know if any of you ever remember the old Salisbury Mall. And that's how long it's gone. And there was a time in my life when I reached a very, very low point. Now, if you were to see me from the outside, you'd think that I had everything. I mean, I worked for a car dealership. I was general manager. I made a lot of money. I drove whatever car I felt like driving. If I wanted to go four-wheel drive, I picked up a four-wheel drive. If I wanted to go somewhere luxury, I took a luxury car. If I wanted to go out sporty, I'd take a convertible. I was single. And from the outside, everything looked great. But I knew inside, my life was a mess. And things seemed to be getting worse instead of better. But it's one of those times in my life, without any hesitation, that I knew God was completely sovereign and had everything under control. Didn't make me feel any better, because I was living for the world, not for God. I had more world than I did Jesus. I mean, I believed, but I wasn't working with God. If anything, I was working against him. But God was still working in me. I went to the bookstore at the Old Salisbury Mall. I went in, and God, it's almost like he picked me by the hand and led me to a section of the bookstore I'd never gone on my own. And he led me directly to a book that would change my life. Now, the book itself was secular in nature, but they got the principles right out of God's Word. The thing is, whether you believe in God or not, if you apply his principles to your life, they will work. The object is, when you see that they work, you believe God is who he says he is. But whether you believe in them or not, his principles still work in life. I wasn't working with God, but God was still working with me. And I remember reading that book that I had a choice. And it was completely up to me. Nobody could make a choice for me. I had to stop my stinking thinking. I had to change the way I was thinking. And if I did, I would be transformed. I would have a new life. a life that had been hidden from me in the past. And I saw this in my own life. When I stopped feeling sorry for myself, when I started having my little pity parties, when I started thinking and changing the way I thought, things began to change. And it didn't happen without me doing my part. I could have read it all day long, but if I didn't apply it to my life, it wasn't going to work. It didn't happen without me doing my part. The choice was mine. I had to renew my mind. I had to change the way I was thinking. I had to repent. I had to stop thinking like a child. I had to grow up, stop feeling sorry for my thing. And I just had to put my childish thinking behind me. And I remember I was reading this book, and I'm sitting on the couch in my apartment, and I made a conscious decision. I made a conscious decision that things were going to be different in my life. I knew I didn't get in this mess overnight, and I knew I wasn't going to get out of it. Years to get to where I was, and it's probably going to take me years to get out. In fact, I'm an analytical person, so what do? I sit down with pen and paper and try to figure out how long it's going to take me. And I figure it's going to take me about 2 years to get out of this mess. But I remember thinking to myself, no matter where you're at, if you know it's going to take 2 years to get out and you put it off for a year, well, now it's going to take you 3 years to get out. And you just wasted a year of your life. And I went to bed that night, and my circumstances had not changed. They were still the same. But I had changed. I knew things were going to be different because I had changed my thought pattern. I had changed the way I was thinking. And when I did, God began to work in me. God began to transform me. In fact, there was such a noticeable difference in my life at the time that the company I worked for had several managers. A guy owned a lot of dealerships, and each one had a different manager. He brings me in the office, and he asks me, what's happened? My work was better. My attitude was better. I was better. And I started telling him about this book and how I changed my thinking. And he went out and bought a very similar book and made every one of his managers read it. There was that much difference in my life. And it all started with me changing the way I think, because a renewed mind will give you a renewed life. And if Jesus says the most important commandment has to do with love, then we need to ask ourselves, how much have I spent in my Christian walk pursuing this love that God has for me and wants me to have for others? Because what do you think the world would look like? What do you think your life would look like? What do you think would happen if just the Christians of the world would walk in this kind of love? See, one thing I know for sure, there'd be a whole lot more Christians because everybody would want what we have. It's not just a bumper sticker and a pin, real love. What would happen if every day, every Christian would just wake up in the morning and say to themselves, how can I make the people around me better? What can I do today to encourage somebody else? How can I be a blessing to somebody else today? But I think instead, most of us, if we're really honest with ourselves, we just lay in bed in the morning and say, when's somebody going to do this for me? Why didn't they do that? Why aren't they doing what I asked them to do? Who's going to love me and act like they love me? But love isn't about getting. Love is about giving. You can't walk in real love until you know what real love is. And you have to receive God, who is love, and let Him love you. Till you know God, who is love, and receive His Son, Jesus Christ, you may be able to do small acts of kindness and small acts of love for a while, but you'll always fall back into your old ways. Must change the way we think to be transformed and be made new. If we want this life that is hidden in Christ in God, we must have Christ Himself. It starts with God loving you first, and then you accepting His love, and then you giving that love back to the world. Change the way you think about your spouse, your children, your friends, your co-workers, your neighbors, whoever you think should do for you. Instead of thinking what they should do for you, start thinking what you can do for them. What can I do for my husband or wife? What can I do for my children? What can I do for my neighbor? What can I do for my friend? What can I do for my coworker? Even those people that you don't find very lovable, whoever God sends into your path, Remove that old attitude of the things of the earth and put on God's attitude, all the things of heaven. See, that's God working in you, conforming you into the image of His Son. But you have to change the way you think to be transformed and given new life. Stop thinking about the way the world sees love and start thinking about the way God sees love. When we see as God does, we'll do as God does. How can you have this love? It is not a dedication of will. How many times have you tried and failed? I mean, let me put it into a different type of form. I'm going to get willpower, and I'm going to go on a diet and lose weight. Has that ever worked? Nope. It works for a little while, but in order for it to work long term, you have to change the old way of thinking, and you have to put on a new way of thinking. You have to look at food different. You have to look at exercise different. You can lose a little bit of weight, but the next thing you know, you're gaining it back. You can't have this kind of love by willpower either. It's a mindset. It's a new way of thinking. You have to put away your childish thoughts and your childish ways. In other words, you have to grow up. When I was a child, I spoke as a child, and I thought as a child, and I reasoned as a child. But when I grew up, I put away childish things. You've got to put away that childish way of thinking. And when you do, God, who is working in you, will transform you. But folks, it doesn't happen right away. This love Paul's talking about is progressive. It happens over time. Those who live only to satisfy their own sinful nature will harvest decay and death from that sinful nature. But those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting life from the Spirit. See, we reap, we harvest what we sow. You sow flesh, you will harvest flesh. If you sow Spirit, you will harvest Spirit. If you sow love, you will harvest love. So let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. See, we might have to love for a little while, but if we don't give up, we're going to reap a harvest of blessing. You might have to love somebody who's unlovable for a long time before you start to see any change in themselves. But let me ask you a question. How long did God have to love you before He began to see a change in you? Has He seen it? Have you changed your way of thinking so that He can change you? If we love somebody over a long enough period of time, not to get anything from them, not even to expect anything back from them, just continue to love them, in time they will come around, and in due time you'll reap the love that you've sown. Love them not because they're lovable. That's easy. Love them simply because God has shown us we're to love them, even if we don't particularly like them. I'm still responsible to God, not them. So I got to love them as God loves them. You keep loving them long enough, you're going to begin to see 1 Corinthians 13:8 in your life. Love will last forever. Love starts with God loving you first, and then you accepting that love, and then you give that love back to everybody you come into contact with. Because I love you, Lord. Because I love you, Lord. I will love that person that's not so lovable. Love should never be a burden. Love should not be a burden. God's commandment should never be a burden. Loving others shouldn't be burdensome. It only becomes burdensome when we try to do it in our own power. It becomes a burden when we don't remain in Jesus so that Jesus can remain in us. God says love is easy when you see as I see. And if you change your way of thinking, if you renew your mind, you'll begin to see as I see. A renewed mind leads to a renewed life. A renewed mind doesn't resist God. We begin to change our way of thinking, we'll progressively grow in love. You won't be able to live as you used to live because you're going to be a new person. What you used to think was okay won't be okay anymore. My mind has been renewed. In time, I will grow and become more kind. In time, I'll be more patient. In time, I'll not be jealous any longer. In time, I won't be as boastful. In time, I will not rejoice in evil, but I will rejoice in truth. Why? Because I've renewed my mind. I have a new way of thinking. Because I'm not copying the behavior and the customs of this world. But instead, I'm letting God transform me into a new person. God is working in me, giving me the desire and the power to do what pleases Him. A renewed mind results in a renewed life. Why have we spent the last 3 weeks on love? Because I want you to remember it. If everything in my Christian walk, if everything I do depends on love, as Jesus says that it does, and as Paul writes that it does, I better know what love is. I better know what love looks like and what love doesn't look like. And I need to know how I can get this love and get a handle on it and how to have it in my life. See, I know what I was without God. I know today that I'm imperfect and I fail time and time and time and time again. And in my own power, I will continue to do so. Apostle Paul wrote to the Romans chapter 13, verse 9, love is the fulfillment of the law. Every requirement God has ever given us is fulfilled in that one word, love. But we have to apply it to our lives. See, unapplied teaching is like unapplied paint. It doesn't do any good. It's got to be applied to be useful. A can of paint sitting in the corner somewhere doesn't make your house look any better. You got to apply it. Unapplied love doesn't transform your life and give you the new life which is hidden in Christ in God. It has to be applied to be useful. What if we saw our wives, our significant others, our husbands as true sons and daughters of a king? What if we really saw them that way? I mean, really, with everything in me, that they were a gift from the greatest king who ever lived. It would be a new way of thinking. You see that person in your life. You see your boss. You see your friends. You see your children. You see your coworkers. You even see your enemies as true children of a king. A king who paid a price that you can't even imagine so that you could be their steward. A king who paid a price so that you could love them and take care of them. To treat them as a king would want you to treat them. And if we began to think like that, it changed the way we act, wouldn't it? Our minds would be renewed, and a renewed mind results in a renewed life, a transformed life. And you can hear transformation by coming to church and singing a couple songs and going to the altar. But a transformed life only comes by God when you have a transformed mind. How can I have this love that the Apostle Paul's been talking about? Let me share something with you. This is such great news. You already have this love. You already got it. You're already loved. God hasn't just said so. He's shown us. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Amen. To those who believe in Him, change your way of thinking and be transformed. Change your thinking. Your Heavenly Father already knows exactly what you need. But first seek His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these other things will be given unto you. It's only when we begin to believe this way that we can have the security of loving others in Christ Jesus. But you have to take the first step of finding love that you seek. I mean, have you taken the step of finding Jesus Christ? Finding this endless love in both actions and in the person of Jesus. If not, I invite you. That's why we've got these altars here. I invite you, I beg you, come to the altar and by faith alone believe Jesus is who He said He is. I beg you, I urge you to do this. Do you believe Jesus Christ died for you? And if you do, repent. Change the way you're thinking so God can change the way you act. I mean, just simply tell God, you know, Lord, I can't do this on my own. I can't even have faith without You, Lord. It's by Your Holy Spirit that anything this. But I know You offered Your Son, Jesus Christ, and I know this is the starting point. So I acknowledge my sin. I acknowledge the fact that I need a Savior. Believe Jesus came to save that which is lost. It's in Jesus Christ that we find this love, and it's in Jesus Christ we see what it means to live this kind of love Paul's describing in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And if you never perfectly confess Jesus Christ to yourself and made him Lord of your life, make today the day that you start your journey of real love. Because God is love and Jesus Christ is God, and therefore Jesus Christ is love. He's the one who doesn't just call us to be a higher standard. He calls us to let him live his life through us. See, that's been the point of the last 3 weeks. But like paint that's still in a can, it's never been applied, none of this would do you any good if you don't apply what you've heard. James, the half-brother of Jesus, said, don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you're just fooling yourself. You just can't come on Sunday mornings, hear what God has to say, and never do what he says to do. You have to apply it, or you're just fooling yourself. What is real love? It's the life of God is love. Anyone who does not know God, but anyone who does not love does not know God, for God is love. God showed how much he loved us by sending his Son, his one and only Son, into the world so that we may have eternal life through him. And then he tells us exactly what real love is. This is real love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. See, real love, agape love, is sacrificial love. Real love is not what you get from others, but what you give to others. True love is the life of God, because God is love. What does real love look like? Real love looks like Jesus Christ. And we're only going to have real love to the degree, and only to the degree, that we have Jesus Christ in our life. How do we get this real love? This is what I want you to leave with here today. First, when it comes to real love, we have a choice. We change the way we think. In other words, we need to repent. A renewed mind results in a renewed life. A life of love that's transformed by God. God isn't working you, but will you work with him? Or will you simply ignore him? Or even worse, will you work against him? The choice is yours. Finish up with this illustration. Both the hummingbird and the vulture fly over the eastern shore. All the vulture sees is rotting meat, things that are dead, because that's what a vulture looks for. They thrive on the diet of the dead and rotting things. But a hummingbird will ignore the smelly flesh of dead animals. Instead, they begin to look for the colorful blossoms of life. The vulture lives on that which was. It lives on the old life. It lives in the past. They fill the things with what's dead and gone. But hummingbirds live on what is. They live on the new life. They seek new life. They fill themselves with freshness life. But here's the thing. Each bird finds exactly what it's looking for. And so do we. If you're looking for death and old life, you will find it. If you're looking for new life and those things which are eternal, you will find it. You will find what you're looking for. The second thing I want you to remember is this. It's not what's going on out there that's keeping you from love. It's not all those other people in your life that's keeping you from love. There are a lot of things in this world that you cannot change, but there is one thing that you can do something about, and that is the way you think. It's not what's out there that keeps you from real love. It's not the people in your life that keeps you from real love. It's not your circumstances that keep you from real love. What goes on right between your two ears. That's what keeps you from love. That's what makes the difference. How can you have real love that's the life of God and manifested by Jesus in your life? The Apostle Paul says, I plead with you, give your bodies to God because all he has done for you. Plead with you. Let them be living in a holy sacrifice, the kind that he finds acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Don't copy the behavior and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Change the way you think. Renew your mind, because a renewed mind results in a renewed life. God will transform you and give you a new life, which is good and pleasing and perfect. And that is a life, that is the life of God, that is a life of love, and that is so important, because three things will last forever: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these things is love. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, we just ask today as we leave here that you put these things into our memory. And Lord, that we just don't leave here and be hearers only, that we don't leave here fooling ourselves, that we begin to apply the things that you have taught us. Father, we praise you, we thank you that you loved us to such a degree that you sent your Son to die so that we could have eternal life and would not perish. Father, it was an example of how we're to love. We're loved sacrificially, but we know we cannot do this on our own. It's only by your power and your Holy Spirit that we can do this. So, Father, if there's someone here today who doesn't know you, may today be the day of their salvation. But, Father, if there are those who say they know you, and yet, Lord, as we all do sometimes, have walked away, that they let their Jesus run low, fill them up to full and overflowing. Let them know that they can go home and change the way they think so they can change the way they act. And if they're just loving for a long enough period of time, that they'll begin to harvest the love that they've sown. Father, we praise you and thank you in the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ. Amen. We invite you all to come out on Wednesday night and join us for our conversation group starting point, and it is exactly that. It's a conversation group. If you'd like the outline, it's out front, but it's not necessary. You can come and join us anyway. And then next week, please come back. Very special service next week by a very special man. A lot of surprises. I think you'll truly enjoy it. And so we do. We ask you to come back next week and join us. We love you. And may the love of God the Father, may the love of God the Son, the love of God the Holy Spirit be in you and among you, wherever you find yourself this week. God bless you. Thank you for being here today.
Amen.